You're listening to the Unwritable Rant Podcast with your host, author, and occasional misanthrope, Juliette Miranda. Go to theunwritablerant.com and you can subscribe on iTunes or connect with the show on Facebook and Twitter.
Hey there, y'all. It's Juliette Miranda. Welcome to episode number 57 of the Unwritable Rant Podcast. I have a lovely glass of rye whiskey sitting here next to me, and I am not going to be drinking alone. We are here to hang out, tell stories, and have a little bit of fun, so y'all get yourself a glass, fill it up, and let's say cheers. Whiskey. This is good stuff, y'all, surprisingly. Now, you know I'm not a huge fan of the rye whiskey, but this is from Town Branch. And I love the Town Branch bourbon. So when I saw the rye, I knew I had to give it a try. It's surprisingly good. It's 100 proof, so it's got a little bit more kick to it. And whereas their bourbon is perfectly suited to summer, their rye is perfect for autumn. It has a very sharp flavor, more so than a lot of the ryes I'm used to. It's got a little bit of citrus on the back end, and it's also got an interesting sort of salty flavor to it. This is definitely a strong drink, and I would not recommend mixing it. It definitely does not belong in a Manhattan, y'all. It belongs on the rocks, just the way I've got it right now. So I'm kind of bummed because I actually broke one of my favorite bourbon glasses last night. You would think that my having had, 15 years of ballet training, I would manage to be a little bit more graceful. But no, I tripped over a crack in the driveway, and that glass slipped right out of my hands. Now, thankfully, no bourbon was lost. And really, losing that glass just gives me another excuse to head back to the bourbon trail and grab another one. But I'll tell you, it does remind me that for all of my bravado, I'm still kind of a dork. Now, fortunately, I'm not quite the same deranged Bridget Jones I used to be. But I certainly have had my fair share of moments where I am not at my best. And that, of course, reminds me of pretty much my entire time in Los Angeles. Oh, you should have seen me back then, in my 20s, all starry-eyed and full of dreams. It was tragically beautiful, particularly considering that I left Los Angeles crushed and battered and world-weary. I just suspect that for whatever reason, I'm not meant to live or work in Los Angeles, and I've got a good 6 years of anecdotal proof of that. None more compelling than the experience I had on my very first day of work at what I imagined was going to be my dream job. I had so many jobs in Los Angeles, but this was the one. It was everything that I wanted. I wasn't answering phones. I wasn't a cruise ship activity director. And let me tell you, that's something I did, and that's a whole horrible story for another day. I wasn't booking prostitutes for a very prominent TV host, which yes, I also did, and no, I won't tell you who he was. Nope. This time around, I walked in as a junior producer, a real job for a real production company with very, very real offices on the corner of Sunset and Vine. Capitol Records was my neighbor at this gig. The Hollywood sign, yeah, that was my view right from my office window. And I'll tell you, walking into the building that very first moment, I really felt as though, all of the effort I had put into getting to Los Angeles and slugging it out in those shitty jobs, I felt like they'd finally been worth something. I thought maybe I had finally done something right and that I was on my way. And once again, the illusion of youth. Oh, it's a beautiful thing. Now, of course, the start of any new job, even the ones in Los Angeles, is pretty boring, right? You spend your first couple of hours sitting with human resources, filling out paperwork and watching training videos on how not to sexually harass your coworkers. It was about 11 a.m. or so when I wrapped up all of that nonsense and got in the elevator and wound up on the 22nd floor. My boss was waiting for me, and I loved this woman. She was everything that I aspired to be. She was a little crazy, she was cool, she was hip, and she had this tremendous creative vibe to her. Like, you knew that even if she was just sitting there staring out the window, she was thinking of something awesome. I was so excited to work with her. Now, unfortunately, for my very first day, she was not able to take me out to lunch, and she was incredibly apologetic about that. Some sort of crazy meeting had come up, but she promised that the very next day we'd get together with all of my new coworkers, and she'd take me out for a fabulous lunch, and we'd all get to know each other properly. But until then, I was on my own. Which is fine. I'm used to being on my own. And this was Los Angeles, and this was my first day at work. I was going to make something special out of lunch. Now, I had no idea where to go, of course, but it didn't matter. I walked out of the building and down Sunset Boulevard, and I found a little sandwich shop called Tidal Wave, where I knew I was going to have a fabulous lunch. Now, here's the thing about Los Angeles in general. You know, you see it in the movies, and you read about it and see pictures of it online. I'm here to tell you, that's all an illusion, folks. Hollywood Boulevard is not a magical line of movie studios and golden stars. It's really a gut-wrenching pit of despair lined with drug addicts and hookers and sex shops. And Sunset, that's not much better. But I don't know, maybe it was the jasmine in the air and the palm trees over my head that was just blinding me, especially at that time, because I managed to overlook some rather distressing issues with the restaurant that I had selected. For example, to get into the restaurant, I had to step over a really large puddle of water congregating at the entrance that had been dripping from the ceiling for a really long time, I'm sure, and was likely seething with Legionnaire's disease. And had my eyes not been so rosy, I might have paid more attention to the fact that I'm pretty sure there was a litter of kittens being born in the potted palm sitting in one corner. And I'll tell you, that place was so empty, my voice echoed when I placed my order. But it was no matter. The lady at the counter was super nice, and I'm sure she really couldn't help the fact that she had several hairs growing out of her chin. But she recommended what I ordered. It was the California Club. And I thought I was being really cute and whimsical by ordering it. You know, California Girl, California Club. Oh, just so clever and fun. And it was me in Los Angeles. It had to be perfect, right? Well, y'all can probably see where this is going, even if I didn't, but that's all right. That sandwich came out alarmingly quick. Not as if it had been, you know, waiting for me, but as if it had been waiting for anyone to order it for, oh, I don't know, a couple of weeks. But I ate that thing anyway, along with the oddly room temperature wilted spinach salad that came with it. Because I was hungry, and of course, it's Los Angeles, the magic store, the Rainbow Connection, the place where dreams come the fuck true. I needed that sandwich to be good. It was my first lunch on my first day. It had to be just right. Now, y'all, I've eaten some very funky sandwiches in my life. Most of them from gas stations on the road as I drove to and eventually away from Los Angeles. But none quite so off as that one. And it wasn't until about an hour later that I realized just how off it was. I returned to the office after my lovely lunch and found myself back on floor 22 with my boss about to take a tour of that entire production studio. There were meet and greets, there was equipment to admire, all sorts of stuff going on, and I was game. So we're walking around and taking in all of the sights, and as we're doing this, I notice the first rumble. Y'all know that rumble that I mean, right? Well, I felt it. But I'm a woman, I'm a strong woman, and I had stuff to do, so I ignored that very first rumble. And I kept walking. I shook hands, I smiled at people, and as I met my boss's boss, I felt the second rumble. It was a little bit more aggressive than the first one, and that made me a little bit nervous, so I reached into my purse and I took out a palmful of Tums. Tums solve all the problems of the world, particularly for a girl who's a drinker like I am. So even then, I had a whole stash of them in my pocket. And I thought, all right, that'll take care of it. And I carried on. Well, this time it's me, my boss's boss, and apparently the CEO of the company who had just joined us because he wanted to meet the new blood. Never mind the fact that I was a cute girl wearing very high heels and a short skirt. So our little group is walking through the studio and we wind up where all the action happens. And it just so happened that at the time they were shooting a production. And I got to take it all in and watch it. And that's when that third rumble occurred. And y'all, by that point, it was too late to do anything about it. My boss is detailing the marvels of this digital state-of-the-art studio. And me, I projectile vomited right across that shiny Hollywood floor with more gusto than Charles Bukowski after a bender. It was spectacular. A dirty rainbow of avocado and chicken and that goddamn weird spinach salad all shooting across the studio at warp speed. Now, vomiting in Hollywood is nothing new. In fact, all of those cute little production assistants and makeup artists and set dressers who were gawking at me, they probably all yacked up their own lunches. Only they had the benefit of being able to do it behind a closed bathroom door and not under anyone's fancy Prada shoes. The last time I put on a display like that was the first grade. And that was thanks to the flu, not my desperate and nearly crippling attempt to live out some ill-conceived fantasy. I was mortified. My boss was mortified. Everybody was disgusted. I sprinted out of that room so goddamn fast, and I curled myself up around the first toilet I could find and purged myself of that stupid contaminated sandwich and most of my dignity. But goddamn it, I cleaned myself up, and I went back to work. And I'll tell you, for 10 months, that was the greatest goddamn job I ever had. Until, of course, they laid me off. Fuck you, Los Angeles. I need a drink. Oh, there we go. Whiskey. That's better. You know, in thinking about my not-so-perfect moments, it is a little bit of a relief to know that we all have them. Even my guy has them, of course. Admittedly, with him, it's a little bit more rare. I'm usually the wacko who causes all the trouble in this relationship, but, you know, every so often he just gets that perfect apex of disorderly mayhem in him, and I love being there to witness it. And that brings me to our last trip to the zoo. At least once every summer, he and I head to the zoo. Now, we have two of them in the greater Chicagoland area, one of them that serves booze and one of them that does not. Guess which one we frequent? I cannot tell you the genius of going to the zoo and having cocktails. And this particular zoo doesn't just sell beer and wine. They sell the hard stuff, too. Oh, yeah, you can wander around the zoo with a Mai Tai, a margarita, a daiquiri, whatever your fancy is. And it's this particular menu item, of course, that has inspired one of our favorite states of being. We like to call it zoo drunk. Now, my guy and I have all sorts of kinds of drunk. You know, there's driveway drunk. There's the slightly terrifying drunky drunk. Being zoo drunk is kind of the equivalent to being Disney drunk. You know, it's based off of a self-contained silliness. You know, where everything just has a slightly more colorful edge to it. And I do want to stress the fact that it is very self-contained. When we are at the zoo, we certainly do not want to ruin anyone's good time. So it's just between my guy and I. Being silly, making poop jokes, giggling, and, you know, taking compromising photos of each other with the animal sculptures. I will say, however, that my guy, when zoo drunk, develops a superpower. And that would be the ability to talk to animals. Now, to be fair, my guy really does have a sort of inexplicable animal magnetism to him. And for example, I came home one day and found him sitting on the driveway with a very large praying mantis sitting on his shoulder. It turned out that thing had fallen out of a tree and waltzed on up to my guy and parked itself on his shoulder. And my guy was pleased as punch about this. He'd even gone so far as to name the thing. So I'm walking up, you know, and I'm a little terrified because I don't like insects. They creep me out. And here's my guy sitting with one on his shoulder. And he looks at me and he goes, "Meet Capri." Well, this alarms me, of course, because he's named it. And that means I'm sure he's a heartbeat away from bringing that thing inside the house and making it a new pet. And I was going to have none of that, because if that thing goes into the house, I'm going to have to burn the house down. Which I explained to my guy very calmly and rationally. And he begrudgingly deposited that praying mantis back onto the tree from where it came. But get this. Every summer since, and we're talking a good 3 summers running now, a praying mantis comes to visit my guy at almost the exact same time every single year. It's the craziest thing. Now, we like to, in our driveway drunken condition, imagine that this is Capri coming back to say hello to its friend, but we know it probably isn't. Nevertheless, there may be all of 4 praying mantises in the Chicagoland area, and somehow one of them manages to find my guy every year. So, of course, you know, get my guy to the zoo, get a couple of cocktails in him, surround him with wildlife, and he becomes a veritable Dr. Doolittle. It always starts in the petting zoo. He can spend an hour in there hand-feeding every single random animal there. You know, he'll be cuddling up with the donkeys, patting the llamas on the head. Meanwhile, I'm left to fend off the mutated squirrels and geese that are hell-bent on tearing my ankles open. Because here's the thing, while my guy may be Dr. Doolittle, my own relationship with animals is a little more hesitant. I just think word got out on me. The animal kingdom knows that I spent my childhood hunting with my dad. I think they have a running tally on the number of squirrels that I've run over. And I'm pretty sure my butcher put out the word that I'm on the hunt for turtle meat. So I go to the zoo and the animals all give me sideways glances, kind of eyeing me as if I'm Damien from The Omen. And I suspect it's just a matter of time before they launch an attack. In fact, one of them even got to me early. We were leaving the petting zoo area and making our way on over to the reptile house when out of nowhere, a duck dive bombs my head. Now, we're not talking just a little, oops, excuse me, I bumped into you. No, this thing launched a full-on, full-scale missile attack, landed smack on my head, and got so tangled up in my hair that one of the zookeepers had to come over and get the thing off me. My guy is on the sidewalk laughing his ass off. Even the zookeeper couldn't keep a straight face. She's like, I've never seen that happen before. This is crazy. Me, I got it. It was deliberate. And I'll tell you something. Those ducks, they look all cute and everything while they're waddling around in their little duck pool. But they're not cute at all. Those fuckers are slimy and they smell funky. And that one left a trail of goo right across my forehead, which meant I had to walk around the zoo for the rest of the day with duck stink on me. There is not enough bourbon in Kentucky to make that okay. Oh, but my guy, he was having a field day with it. Every time we would walk past any sort of winged creature, he would make a motion as if to throw me to it. And I admit, as a bystander, that was probably pretty funny. And I hope my guy was enjoying himself because the tables were about to be turned. We had pretty much seen everything that there was to see at the zoo, and I was thinking, all right, maybe this is about time for me to pick up my phone and call Uber. When I saw my guy get that look. It's the same look that I get when something strikes my fancy. When something is just so wacky and absurd that, you know, in my zoo drunken condition, it seems like the greatest idea ever. So I look at my guy and I follow his gaze and I see that we are standing in front of Stingray Bay, the petting pool for stingrays. I know, deep in my soul, this is a bad idea. It is a rotten, terrible, no good, ridiculously bad idea. But my guy, he's got the look. So I've got to follow him into the petting pool of stingrays. Now, Stingray Bay wasn't so much a bay as it was a gigantic kiddie pool stuffed full of about 20 stingrays or so. I always find these attractions to be just the slightest bit cruel. You know, if I were a stingray, I wouldn't want to be flopping around in murky water while five-year-olds bop me on the head every 30 seconds or so. Well, five-year-olds and my guy, of course. We hadn't even been in there more than 5 seconds when my guy is on his knees leaning into the kiddie pool and he is surrounded by stingrays. Even the goddamn stingrays flocked to my guy. It was the craziest thing. All he had to do was reach his hands into the water, float him around a little bit, and all of a sudden he's got a good 10 stingrays flopping around and rubbing their little stingray heads up against his hands. He looks over at me and he's got one of those big shit-eating grins on his face and he goes, I am Lord of the Stingrays. Me and my stingray army will one day conquer the world. Well, I smile at him, of course, but I'm not going to let him get away with that statement. And I look over and I see that there's one stingray in the center of the pool who's not quite as smitten with my guy as the rest. So I say, some army. You've got mutiny already. There's one stingray over there who certainly hasn't succumbed to your rule. Well, he looks over and sure enough, there's that stingray sitting in the center of the pool, completely oblivious to his charm. And that, to my guy, was unacceptable. He leans forward a little bit and tries to work his stingray magic. I see his hands working in the water and him going, here, stingray, stingray, stingray. And that thing will have nothing to do with him. It's treating him as though he's some guy in a park wearing a raincoat. And my guy is doing everything in his power to lure that thing over. He leans it a little bit further. Now, I would like to be able to tell you that that stingray came over to my guy and nuzzled up to him just like the other ones did. But I can't do that. What I can do is tell you that as my guy leaned forward to lure that stingray over, he lost his balance and fell right into the stingray pool. And for a pool that was maybe 3 feet deep, he made one hell of a splash. There is water everywhere, stingrays flopping around, children crying. It was the greatest live animal show I have ever seen. And I'll tell you, the only thing he attracted the attention of was two very annoyed zookeepers who rush on over and try to yank him out of the stingray pool. My guy was soaked from head to toe, covered in stingray goo and whatever was on the sticky hands of the five-year-olds that had been there first. They got him a towel pretty quickly, a zoo towel, of course, which was probably just previously used to wipe down a couple of dolphins. And the next thing you know, my guy and I are being escorted very politely but very firmly towards the zoo exit. Now, a tragic side note to this story is that a couple of months after my guy's incident there, all of the stingray mysteriously died. That's right, the zookeepers came in one morning and found them all belly up in the pool. Now, I'm not saying my guy had anything to do with that, because I'm sure he didn't. But I will tell you this much. We are never, ever going to the aquarium. And with that, I'm going to have a little bit more bourbon. Hang on, y'all. Oh, that's good. Well, thank y'all for listening to this episode of the Unwritable Rant Podcast. Don't forget, if you want to catch up on all of the back episodes, you can just go to theunwritablerant.com. They're all right there. Or you can find links to all the places where you can subscribe to this show, including iTunes, iHeartRadio, and Stitcher. Or find me on Twitter. I'm at Morning Neurosis. I love hearing your bourbon recommendations. So if you've got something specific you want me to drink on the show, hit me up on Twitter. And with that, y'all, I'm going to head on out. Hope you have a great week. I will be back again next Sunday. Cheers, y'all.